Brigham Young University, USA, is doing a project where it interviews family members about their life experiences. Can I ask you some questions about life now and about when you were growing up?
Yes.
We would like to record what you say to help remember the details. The university will provide you access to your interview through the project website at CambodianOralHistoryProject.byu.edu. Do we have your permission to conduct the interview and post it online?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Now you learned Khmer. Now it's kind of interesting how you learned Khmer. How did you learn Khmer?
Well, back in 1979, I left my country, Cambodia. I was 9 years old and crossed the border of Cambodia to Thailand's camp. And at that time, it's not a proper camp. They just cut out the trees and they provide tents and for each family to have a tent to sleep at night. So we all moved into that camp. How we get there was there's a like a yellow school bus, and it's lots of bus lining up. And they telling us, if you want to look for freedom, live in another country, you can come and join us. We'll have a place for you here for temporary. So a lot of people, families come in, get into the bus. And then they took, I don't know how long it take, but and then they delivered us to this camp called, place called Kawedang. That's how they named the camp, the big place near the mountain. The mountain there, and then we're right on the bottom, and they cut out trees and give us time to stay, and then they create a family card. And then, each individual families accounting how many, they start with 3 person and up as a family. So my sister and her son, which is 2 years old, younger than me, the three of us, since my sister's a young age, like she's in the mid-20s, 22 maybe. And then her son is like 6 or 7 years old, and I was 9 years old. And so the three of us, she looked so young with the kids, so they put her with another older lady who in the mid about 50 or 60 years old to make one family. They bring another person, it's look like a mother, a daughter, and the two kids. So we'll become a family. And then, if 2 people, they don't consider family. And if you're too young and you're alone, they're gonna group you up with other people to try to stay together. So that way it's easy for them to provide meals, food, and some clothes and some water to drink.
How did that work out? Did that family arrangement work pretty well for you? Did you get along pretty well?
It's all right, but then she decided to, I think she stayed with us. Yeah, she stayed with us. But then later on, I think she found her kids or something that she can, she just go join her family. And my sister and the three of us become as a real family, and nobody wants to join us. So they consider like, okay, family of three. So when time to provide some meat, they'll say family of three, you take this portion, family of five, take this portion. They lay them on the ground and with a carpet or something, plastic paper to cut up the meat, provide us meat once a week.
Were you hungry quite often?
Not really, we eat rice, or they provide us rice. So we make our own food, make soup or cook rice, and then with the meat or some noodle, whatever they provide us is pretty much enough for the week. So every Tuesday we would go and get some food from them.
Now you weren't able to read or write before you came to camp, were you?
No, and then after
wasn't it pretty much prohibited by the?
No, it's a brand new place, so everything
before you got there. They didn't allow you to learn reading or writing.
No. Oh, that's in my country.
Back in Cambodia.
Yes, yeah. It was 1979. It was during the Civil War. Vietnam tried to take over the land. Of course, they're fighting, but they don't hurt the people. So we all run free to everywhere. And everybody try to go to their hometown, and some of us just tried to go anywhere.
And so once you came to this refugee camp, this was
the border of Thailand, and then we see the people like, oh, they're gonna go to a new country, to a different country. So it sounds like a good idea because there's no food, yeah. No school. We were captured by Khmer Rouge and to stay in one place, and there's no school for kids, only one meal per day, and adult does have
a Were you pretty
time.
Hungry at that time?
Oh, yes, yes. Well, that's why we left our country, because there's no food, no school.
Is that how you determined that it was time to leave Cambodia when that happened? Or what was the, how did you come to the realization that I've got to leave this place?
Oh yes, because everybody run the same time. It's like, I think the Vietnamese armies come into where we capture not to leave the place. So when the Vietnamese armies come, it's kind of like free us. So nobody dare to protect or to hurt us anymore. And nobody take charge. So everybody kind of like, oh yes, we're free to go anywhere we want. So since there's no food, no clothes, no, it's not much, and a lot of killing that time too. We call it Pol Pot, the guy who is the leader of that place called Pol Pot. We never see him in person, but his name is like the president, the priority. Everybody must listen to his people, what they tell us to do. If we don't, we get rid of. They're gonna kill families. They don't hurt kids, or they let kids go free, but the kid who is old enough to work, they will send them to the river and try to dig out the things that sink in the river. When the rivers, the water go lower, they try to make little kids who is old enough to work to gather the stuff from the river to them, for them.
Did they put you to work before you left Cambodia?
A little bit. I was 9 years old, but I wasn't look strong. I'm so skinny. And I wear my father t-shirt and go down to river where they said, look for some good stuff that we'd be able to use, bring them to the leader. So we don't have school. We just kind of like pretty much play all day with the little kids.
Uh-huh.
So okay. I think since I don't have food, it doesn't nourish my memory. So I don't remember anything before I was 9 years old.
So as you were leaving Cambodia, were you afraid of being captured?
Oh, yes, yes. We all leaving our place by lowering ourselves down really low to at night. We can hear shooting, bombing everywhere. Some family get killed because they know people running everywhere. It's like, imagine like everywhere is at war, like nobody feels safe. Everybody make sure gather their family, sleep under the trees at night. Or there's some people stay in a little bit field, they dig down the hole in the ground and try to cover something up so they can breathe and stay hiding at night. In daytime, they try to move away from the country as far as they can to the border of Thailand.
How long did it take you to get to Thailand? To where?
It might be a couple of days. We're not too far from Thailand. We were pretty close to the border. They call Big Mountain and Small Mountain, which is pretty much close to the Thailand.
Okay. So, did you travel at night rather than during the day?
Absolutely, yes. At daytime, we kind of take it easy, and we have some, not by ourselves, but in a group. So we kind of help protect each other and keep the eyes on if you see any soldier, because they're all over the place. If you see any soldier, we'll kind of whisper and tell the kid not to cry, not to make noise. We're going to go quiet. And luckily, we've been safe, and nobody really heard us. But other people, you can hear them screaming and all that, and just feel luckily as we travel along on the like a freeway. But there's no car ever, never seen a car. But there is a freeway that you can walk a lot of, hundred thousands of family walk on. You look to the side, you see all dead body there alongside. So it's kind of scary. Everybody stay in the same group and keep going. Keep going, moving. Some we walk at nighttime. Some take the rest there, a little bit to the side, walk. They keep walking day and night as far as they can, as far as their feet take them. When they tired, they just stay, and then the other families keep going, moving along.
Were there quite a few casualties in your family with losses, deaths of people in your family at this time?
I don't know much, but I heard that I have 11 siblings, including me, 11. I'm the 10th. And most of them probably got sick and died. And I only know that I have a brother, two sisters, and me. So that's what is left for my family. And my father saw me and my nephew walk along with other people, and he said to my sister, "Go with your son and your sister, go find a new life in a different country. I want to stay here in my birth country." And my sister's teasing him back, saying, "That's it, I don't care if I die or not, I'm not gonna come back, I'll just go and be gone." And my father says, "No, come back, Min, come back." And she doesn't really listen, but my nephew and I walk along with other people. We got no love, no nothing. It's like us kids, all we think about is food. We want to eat. We want to go somewhere.
That's very interesting. What foods did you eat? And what did you have a favorite food?
Well, never mind favorite. As long as you have something to put in your stomach. We trade in all our belongings, like a bowl with what you call it? It's not silver.
We use stainless steel. We use ceramic. What?
Yeah, some like what's that called?
Tupperware.
Cup or something? Cup. Cap a cup.
Copper,
yes.
Copper.
Yeah, it's like orange, not really gold,
copper.
But it's like bright. We have a beautiful bowl. We have to trade that in for beans.
Beans?
Yeah, because we cannot afford rice or anything out. Whatever we can, trade all our good stuff that we have with us, get rid of it, so we can have some bean to eat. That's replaced for rice, because I don't think there's rice really much to trade in for anybody. So we all pretty much empty-handed with just a piece of clothes with us while we're traveling. Just one pair of outfit, each one of us. We don't really have anything to carry except spoon and maybe a little knife to use. That's pretty much empty-handed when I come over here.
So did you carry your food with you or find it
on
the way?
There's no food.
No food?
We trade anything that we think they would take it for beans. We eat beans like, I want to say 2 or 3 months there at the border before we see the yellow bus to come.
How did you get across the border? Is there a river that you have to cross to get into Thailand?
Okay. There's no river, pretty much land.
Were there games that you played when you were growing up, or friends that you played with, or?
There's the game we have is there's no paper game or. But there is a board game called chess. You walk in a row, and or a jumping rope, yes.
Oh, yes.
Or a little bit, elastic circle, the small one. They sell those. Some family can buy for their kid. So we play those like we play in bed. So we draw a circle over there, and if you can bring your elastic over there into the hole, as many as you can, a whole bunch, every tip in, like you do five, I do five, you do. And then we do like paper, scissor, rocks. Or if you win, you go first. And then whoever wins next, go and take turn. And then as much as elastic you can put in that hole, that's what you win, that much. That's what they agree to. It's like you win the elastic to, to keep it. That's your treasure as a kid. We don't have any fancy game. Or it's a little bit, there's circle and then they do rocks. So again, we do paper, scissors. Whoever's win get to walk first. So when you walk all the rocks and you're done with it, I think you get to grab the next one for your winning. But sometimes they try to put as much they can going a little bit faster. Try to make like a strategy. You do which way you go first, and the last hole that don't have a hole, the next one you can grab that. And sometimes people are smart, they have a lot of rocks there. And some just a few.
Did you have toys to play with? Did you ever have a doll?
No, but you can make one from a scarf. they roll on each side, tied it up. There's a hands and legs. There's a while with like baby.
Did you ever make one of those?
Yeah.
Did you have one of those that you played with? Okay. What about pets? Any pets?
No. The other people have cats.
All right. Did you learn any songs when you were growing up? Did you like music or?
We don't have kids' music. Very rare that they at school that they build for us, and some kids' song from school. There's a few songs, but most people, most kids singing adult song. Because adult song, you know, old time Sin Sisamut, he's the famous one in Cambodia. He sing, his voice makes you happy. And the word that he says out is drive you like in a good mood. Like everybody said, he have a golden voice. Everybody love to sing along. Even though we don't understand the meaning, the lyrics of the song, when we just sing it out, it just make us feel joys.
Do you remember your house in Cambodia?
Did you have a house.
No house in Cambodia.
No, there wasn't.
Now, when you got to the camp, I don't imagine you had electricity.
Oh yes, when you get into the land, they provide you tents.
Uh-huh.
You stay there for a couple of months. I don't remember how long. Later on, they build a school. They build like a cottage. There's roof and then wall. That's it. And then they build a bamboo bed. So we stay in a bamboo bed, sleep at night with the little net so mosquito won't get into you.
Oh yes.
And then you, on the ground, there's lots of dirt. So you dig a hole and you put three rock, big rocks so you can cook, set a fire on in that hole and cook the rice, make the soup, or fry, whatever you want. You cook inside the, in your own room. It's like just one room they provide us to.
And then there must have been a hole in the top where the smoke could go out?
It's not like a close up wall. It's like a roof and then just halfway down and then the wall. They all make from bamboo. So
yeah.
There's no ceiling through the wall. There is a hole on the top. It's almost like a bathhouse at the beach. It's just one big room and there's one bed they build for you. And you sleep on the bed. Everything else stay on the floor. Or
so did you go to a common place to get water to bring to your?
No, they provide you water. They say family of three, you get this much a bucket of water. You go bring them to your place where you stay.
Uh-huh.
So my sister had two big bucket like this. I put the stick one in front, one in back, and I carry them to my resident. Well, we go a little bit further, like about 10 minutes walk, I think. You carry it from there because they have a big tank of water. And then by the end of the day, the water is all gone from the tank and they give it to family by tank. So I'm just pretty much with my older sister and I and my nephew, but unfortunately he didn't make it. One time he played the ball with other kids or watch other kids and the ball run over to the side. He tried to go grab it and he accidentally stepped into the ground where they build fire to cook. So, and then he probably get infection and there's no medicine for it. And then he died before he make it to here. He almost make it here, but he didn't make it.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah.
So they gave you options of where you would could go, or
yes, where? After they build the house, they make the family cart. As we step into the refugee camp, they build up a family cart, and then they build a house for us to sleep in, and then they start building the school for our own language for kids who never get to go to school. They have it up to fourth grade. So I was blessed to get to stay there for 5 years. My sister was a teacher, teach Cambodian classes to the little one, and then later on she teach to the big kids, the teenager kids, and that's all they have.
And that's where you learned to
I learned
read
Cambodian,
and write?
Read and write for 5 years there.
In Khmer?
In Khmer, yes.
Okay, that was a blessing to be able to go to school, wasn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Let's see. What about coming to the, do you remember you were given a choice to come to the USA or some other places.
Yeah, so every month I post the name, we call it family name, like whoever the child of family, he or she would go look into the board, posting board, what you call that, club board, near, now it's City Hall, there they have a place like that, and then they post the name, who's gonna interview, when, what's the date, and then so as we play, we keep go check, see if our name's on the board. If our name's on the board, we can go for interview. And they review everybody's name again, age and all that. And then my sister is take the longest because we don't know anybody who come here first can sponsor us. You cannot just come, you have to have a sponsor. Somebody who would introduce you the place to stay, a place to go get food, a place to go to school. So nobody can do that introduction for us. So we wait there, it's like 5 years. And then my sister, who is a teacher with her at the time, she get called to come here first, because maybe she knows somebody who here first. So she sent a letter, sent some little money for us, and then my sister used her as a, her friend as a sponsor. And then we get called. Just right before we left, there was a big robbery, and it just started shooting. It's like, uh-oh, this is not, it's just right on time, you know? We just get out there right on time, 1984. And then unfortunately my sister didn't have me, I did not know that my name was Chip. At the time she told me to put my name in school, Proeung. Proeung, it can be a guy or a girl. And unfortunately the thief, the big thief that they caught is also named Proeung. So the whole school make fun of me. Say, oh, be careful, you know, Proeung's gonna go to your house at night. So I was teased by my schoolmates and I say like, great, I didn't know my name was Chip on the card until I get here. And I didn't like that name, Chip. They called Jeep, like Jeep, 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 like a little birdie, Jeep, 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 crying too much.
And what year is it that you came to the USA?
1984.
1984,
yeah.
And how old were you then? 14.
14? 14 years old.
And did you go to school?
We don't get out there quickly. We it takes time. They have to place us. They take us out from Thailand's camp into transit. That's another part of Thailand. And then from transit, we I don't remember if we take the airplane or not. Transit about 3 to 5 months, and then they ship us to Philippine Island. And again, in the Philippine Island, it's pretty much like the island. It's beautiful. They have stream. They have beach. That's the first time we introduced, and we see cars and all that. It was beautiful, and we stayed there about 7 months. And again, while we stay there, they have to exam us, like physical exam. They have us take off all our clothes, nothing on, and they just want us to turn around to make sure we got no wounds, no any open wound, any sickness at all. But then they poke, they test your blood.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you have some kind of disease,
tetanus.
And then you stay longer.
Yeah.
If not, then you stay about 5 to 7 months and you get out. Otherwise, you're gonna stay there until you heal. They give you medicine, I think. But luckily, we were okay, and we stayed there. As we stay there, most kids, I don't know about adults, but most kids, they need to go to school again for introduction to English. When you go to USA, you can need to know what things are called, like the fruit, supermarket, inside supermarket, and words you're gonna use to ask to get around, and the telephone. This is a introduce us. This is telephone. They have it over there. We pick up the telephone and swing with the numbers, like okay, and cars. And we start learning English. It's not alphabet. Not ABC, just start to call like, this is a chair, like this is a chalkboard, you know, they have a book that they publish and for us to read by the pictures.
And that was your introduction to English.
Yes, and then it take me 7 months there, and then that we fly over to United States. And as we change the airplane, and it was interesting. I was looking at this lady with red lips and with the coats on. I was like, is this really a person? Or like going around and staring at her like crazy. And then it was like, and then the introduction to the bathroom, like, wow, this is awesome. Because in Thailand's camp, they dig a hole and they put like three shape, like triangle shape, you sit there and there's no water to clean, so you wipe yourself with paper or anything you can find. So, but at the airplane, like the airport is like, it was like, this is a big dream I can never thought about. It's like, it's awesome. I love the shining white and people look so pretty around. Like, and then when come to Boston, get off the airplane, it's like, I heard snow. Like, how do people live with the snow? And then I saw the ice, like the snow right on the car. So I just tasted it, like, this is look like shaved ice. It looks good. So I tasted it, like, oh, it's just water. Like, it was like interesting. Like, okay, they wear thick clothes and it's so cold, but I don't feel cold. I'm still warm. Like, they give me a coat, I'm just hold on to it and look at everybody like, oh, it's interesting. How do, why do you wear so big clothes? Like, as we stay in for about 2 weeks, and then I realized, oh yeah, snow is cold now. I start to feel the cold. And then my sponsor enrolled me right into Lowell High School. I was 14 years old, never learned alphabetical, just go straight. And the teacher called my name, I absent every day because I don't answer my name correctly. I don't understand my name. It's called Chip. Chip, like, I get used to Jeep. They call my name Jeep in Khmer. Like Jeep, and then like, oh wait, but I was Pirom and now I'm Jeep, or like Chip, like, I don't know, I've kind of messed up with my name. I don't like my sister do that to me.
So how is it now? You okay with it now?
Now I'm kind of like, it's all right. And then when I become a citizen and I forget to change my name, like, I want to change my name, but I understand much. And of course I learned through, as I joined the church, I learned a lot in English, how to speak and write and listen to people.
Did they treat you good when you went to school? You went right into,
right came into right Lohai, to Lowell? They have, they gave me three class of Cambodian teacher. Yeah. And he speak my language, but he tried to teach us, I don't remember, it's a long time ago, but we'll just be there because, well, we have to be in school, but we don't really learn anything. I mean, I don't really learn anything much. But well, at that time, there's a lot of people that's about my age.
You learned quite a bit. You speak English very well.
Not until like a couple years later, about after I quit Middlesex Community College. Well, mm-hmm. I go to Lowell High School for 4 years.
Uh-huh.
And then when I graduate, I get financial help. So I go to Middlesex College for 2 years, and I cannot go any further because my sister is alone. And when she works, she rent the place, she pay the car and insurance, but she get laid off. And then there's not much to try to survive. So I have to quit and work part-time. Oh, actually, like, go back. I was on my last day to graduate. It's like I was go to my graduation. And just before my graduation, the missionary, the elders, they found, and at that time they were the same age as I do. And a lot of my people saying, oh, look at Chip, she got a boyfriend who is white. They all like make fun of me, people that know me from school and my neighbor, and say they thought that I have boyfriend, American boyfriend, and because they're the same age. And then one day the missionaries, I thought it was funny, they knock on the door and they try to find a non-active member, and they found us. They invite us to the church, and one day they learned Khmer, and they called me, oh, and I was laughing, because you know how kids are, when you make a mistake, they just laugh at you. They're not laughing at you. And then the missionary was like feeling a little embarrassed. I could see his red cheek, like, oh. I say, you call me like a sweetheart, you know? And then he like, no, I don't mean that, sister. And the missionary said, oh, when's your graduation? I say, June 7 or 8. And he said, oh, let me go to your graduation. Do you have any friends and family? I said, no, just my sister, and my sister don't go. And she can stay home and watch her kid, because Sotet was just like a year old. And then so the missionary tried to support me. They went there, the two of them went there. It's like, they take picture, and that was one shot, and there's last, the end of their film. And then we make some food at home, and they celebrate. Say, you know what? Let's put soda and I think soda and ice cream. They try to make a trick, and when you drink and you kind of burp, and they thought it was funny and they liked it. They would have party, but the missionary, just me, my sister, and her little son, and the missionary come over, and they try to have the blast out of it. And that was, I'm so glad that we have somebody to celebrate with. Otherwise, it was just like nothing, you know? It was such a great memory.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So, do you want to tell us a little bit about your working career, or how, where you worked, or?
Sure. I go to the church. So I work part time at Market Basket.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And then my sister, at that time they don't have low ward. We have a Baraka Chapel. We attend there. And back then, missionary was allowed to pick up people. They have their own car to the Baraka Chapel, and a lot of Cambodian joined, thousands of families. And then we go there. And of course, I don't speak English well, but after 2 years in Middlesex, I'd be able to speak a little bit. And then I was asked to translate. I was like, oh, I was nervous, but for some reason, the Holy Ghost must have support me, and I'd be able to speak on the stage and try to translate a couple, because that back then it was a lot of Cambodian old people, older than me, like my sister's age, and they don't understand English at all. And I'd be able to speak some, so they asked me to translate, and I tried my best, and I think the Holy Ghost helped me to translate, because I can read Cambodian, so they provide the Book of Mormon in Cambodia, but it's not completely translated, it's just half of it. But I read a couple of times, and I know the story, and I try to use every word, look up dictionary, be able to give them some help there. And I was enjoy learning in Relief Society cooking class, and we had so much fun. And then one day, after I asked the Lord that I want work full time there, and thank goodness he did not let me work there. I even cried. I said, Lord, why you not let me work full-time in Market Basket? I need money, and I need to work full-time. So when I asked the manager, he said, he give me as much time as I can, but I cannot give you full-time. And then I was crying in my car. I said, I was blaming the Lord. I said, the Lord did not bless me the job that I wanted it, but guess what happened? It was a miracle happened. Missionary said, you ask the Lord yourself, ask with sincere heart, you get your what you want. You get what you need. Sometimes you don't think that you want. I mean, sometimes you want, but you don't think you need it. You not really need it, but you want it. Then anyway, I want Market Basket full time, but no. So I was disappointed, and I was crying, and I knelt down and asked, pray the Lord after I graduate high school. I said, can I go to the college? And I did get go to college. I didn't ask if I want to graduate it. So I did not graduate, but I did get to go as I asked the Lord that I want to go college to get some experience. And I did. And then later on, while I was in high school, I worked two summer program at the Lowell District Court. And I have some experience there. So as the Lord rejected my work full-time in Market Basket, my old boss come and make a purchase at my register, and she say, Chip, you want to work at your old place? Because a lot of people retired, they need more help. I was like, my heart was lifted, like, that's my dream job. I want to work in the office. I want to dress up nice, I like dressing up. So since then, I'm stop blaming the Lord, because I know he had something in good story for me. It was amazing, and I want miracle, and I have seen a lot of miracle. And one day I go to college, my car doesn't work. I don't have a car, I didn't take the car to work. And I'm on my way back home, it was dark, and it's like half an hour walk. For my car, maybe 5-10 minutes, but walk like half an hour. So I pray. Ask the Lord if I can get home safely. And it was kind of dark and a little scary, and I don't feel safe because back then I was like 19 years old, I think. I was scared. And anyway, guess what happened? My classmate, she and her husband pick her up, but she's halfway to her own home. It gets stuck, so she decided to get around. And she saw me just start walking from the school, and then she offered me a ride. I said, this is not a miracle that she gave me a ride home, which I afraid to walk home. So, and then again, as I joined the church, and I asked the Lord if I can have a family. I like Cambodian guy, and there's no Cambodian guy joined the church at all. A couple years later, like nobody, just women, a couple of us, 5-10 women, that there's no guy at my age. So I have asked the Lord, I like to have experience to have family, have a kid, and he did bless me for that. But that's not what I really truly said, what I really really want. But he did bless me because I guess I must have needed, because I've asked him to have experience as a mom and you know, have a family like other people, because I feel kind of lonely. And just with my sister, I don't have to get experience how parents, how would be happy, how much would it be to stay with parents. But I only get to stay with my sister as a sister. Most people tell me sister is not like mom. They don't give you everything you want. And then I feel like, not that I'm selfish, I just wanted an experience. So I have asked the Lord, and thanks the Lord for my sister being a mom and a sister. And now I realize that it must be the Lord who delivered me here to this country. I'd be able to learn, and I learn a lot and have lots of experience, and most experience that I have asked the Lord for. And I just remember, like, yeah, why did they say, be careful what you ask for? I never understand that word until later in life I realized that, like, oh my goodness, when I look back to my experience, like, oh, how much different. It's all, my life experience always going up better. It never worse, it's always better.
Better's good.
Yes.
Now you have a daughter.
Yes, and my daughter is now 20 years old, and she had a son, which made me a grandmother.
What a blessing to have a daughter.
Most people
tell
me.
And a granddaughter, a grandson.
That I'm a young grandmother. I was like, really?
Yes. You've been blessed. Is there anything else you'd like to tell us about your family?
Well, I've only had my older sister who I stay with now. To her, I'm still her baby sister. And she still helped me some advice, and along with other stuff, as I'm not brave to live by myself. I'm still attached to her. And I'm sure she's pleased to have company. If she stay alone, if she needs help, she won't know who to call. Even the three of us now, my older sister and her son. But whatever the reason is, she's not feeling comfortable asking her son to take her here and there or talk to him much. She just feels more comfortable with me as sisters, even to the supermarket.
Well, it's good to have family. It's good to have sisters and moms. You've told about some of the challenges you faced in life. Are there some other challenges you'd like to tell us about, or is that pretty well sum it up?
Very much.
What about some happy times? You told about a happy time with celebrating your graduation, and there are some other happy times that you can remember that you'd like to tell us about?
That was the first happy time with the missionary who is trying to teach and learn Khmer at the same time. And I have so much fun because they make mistakes and I laugh at them and they don't mind. They never get angry with me. The elder was so awesome. They brought a lot of joys to my family, actually.
Would you, if you were going to give some advice to children or great-grandchildren, is there something that you would want to leave a message for them? Is there something special you'd
like to tell? As I learned in life, never take things in a rush. Go easy. There is one time I took a day off from work and go home and try to make some good dinner for my older sister because she works and I work too, but I want to surprise her and thought about thank you her for taking care of me. So I say, I'm gonna cook good for her. So I went to market, Cambodian Asian market, and get a few things to make a soup. As I came out to the car, I look at the time, my sister's gonna be home soon. So I'm kind of rushed backing up and I re-ended someone and he was screaming at me. And the owner of the store said, oh, don't bother call the police, just work things out. Like, oh, cool. How could you work things out with a person who is so mad because his car is so brand new and my car is kind of old car? And then I say, okay, for some reason, I guess the Holy Ghost must have prompted me not to be yelled at him back. I just tell him nicely. I said, okay, let me go tell my insurance and you go take your car to repair shop, okay? I tell him that. I don't know if he's Vietnamese or Cambodian, but he's pretty upset because I scratched his car all the way like this, like that long. And so I drove over to the insurance agency and tell, I re-ended someone, what should I do? And they said, oh, don't worry, we'll take care of it. And my heart was like, oh, that's it? That's so easy? Like, I'm so happy. And then since then, I'm like, I'm gonna take my time, back out the car, go in, and I'm still a new driver. And my sister told me not to ask any guy to move the car from the parking for me. I need to learn it myself. That's why I struggle and I'm careful. And since then, and one more accident, I would drop off my nephew and I was in a hurry and I bumped into this car in the back of him and he took off. And my car hood was like open up and smoke coming out. And I don't feel nervous for some reason. I don't feel scared. And again, I think maybe because I was in a good, I was in a process of getting a lot of miracle. And in any way, so I turned off the heat and the smoke stopped. So then again, I called my insurance agency. They said, oh, we're gonna send you a list to take your car to have estimate and get a repair. That's the only two accidents in life since I drive it for about 30 years, over 30 years. Since then, I learned very well not to go anywhere in a rush. Take time so you won't make mistakes.
So that's the advice you'd like to give them is take your time.
Do things
don't
right.
Don't be in a rush, do them right. Okay, that's good advice. I'd like to thank you for your interview. I think that that's something that is going to be really special for your family. Thank you so very much.
You're welcome.